So in this next video, we're going to talk about clinical thinking in the emergency department. And let's do it by way of an example. And so let's say that you have a patient who comes in with a headache. Now, the way that you've been taught before in order to evaluate your patients is you start by asking them a bunch of questions, a bunch of details. And these are your PQRST features that you've always been taught to ask, like the onset, the quality, severity. You may even throw in some associated factors and past medical history. And then from all these details, you start making your differential diagnosis. And then you start making connections between these, between your things and the diagnosis. But how many things can kill this guy? It's probably a lot, and it's a lot more than you have here. And what if the thing that is his diagnosis is one of the things that you didn't think of? And so that could potentially kill this guy. And we don't have a lot of time to waste. So this sort of thinking that you've done here is called bottom-up thinking, meaning that you start with the details and move up to the diseases. Now, this is not how an emergency physician thinks. We use a top-down thinking, which means that we start with the diseases and then we look for the details. So what this means is we start with a differential diagnosis and then we look for supporting or contradictory evidence for those diagnoses in our differential. And the diseases that you should put into your differential should be anything that could kill you or injure your patients. And so we kind of start with that paranoid mindset that they have all these bad things, and we look for the details that prove that they either do or do not have those things. And those details that we look for, those are called our illness scripts. And these are the defining or distinguishing features of a disease, the signs and symptoms that you're going to look for that make a disease more or less likely. These are also the things that you want to put in your chart. These are the red flags that you're looking for to prove that you've thought of all of these things. So I think the best way to go through this is to use an example. So let's go back to our patient that's suffering from a headache. And the first thing that we do with all of our patients is we look at the primary survey, which includes your ABCs, your airway, your breathing, and your circulation. It may include other things in other disease processes, but for here we'll say ABC. One of the other initial things you do is your initial actions, which are time-sensitive things that need to be done pretty quickly. And in most patients in the emergency department, that's going to be IV, establishing an IV, putting them on oxygen, and putting them on the cardiac monitor. And what the primary survey really does, what the purpose it serves, is to make sure that your patient is not going to die. Because if they're going to die, it doesn't matter what they have. Stop them from dying. And then, once that's the case, you can move on to the next thing, which will be your secondary survey. Now, how do you do your secondary survey? You need to have your differential diagnosis. And remember that the differential diagnosis, yeah, it'll probably have migraine and tension headache on that, but that's not what we're looking for. We're looking for the killer diseases, the killer diagnoses. And so you want to have a pretty comprehensive list of things that are going to kill anyone who comes in with a headache. And so what would you put on this list? You'll have a couple of stroke symptoms, a stroke, a cerebellar infarct, which could quickly lead to herniation, subarachnoid hemorrhages, bleeding in the head, carotid and vertebral artery dissections, which can happen from mild trauma, and epidural and subdural hemorrhages, which can happen from bigger traumas, though sometimes, especially on old people and people who are anticoagulated or alcoholics, they can have mild trauma as well that causes this. Other things you're going to want to put on the list include glaucoma, carbon monoxide poisoning, right? This can kill somebody when they, especially they go back home to it. Glaucoma will affect their vision. Temporal arteritis can lead to permanent blindness, also called giant cell arteritis, and a brain tumor. Now look how different this list is from the one that we came up by using bottom-up thinking. We only had a few things in our differential here. Here we have a pretty big differential diagnosis. And contrast this from the primary headache syndromes like migraines, cluster, and tension, which tend to be headaches that are recurrent. You know, the patient has had these before. They can hurt a lot, and they can be pretty distressing. But these ones are probably not going to kill you. The other ones are, these secondary headaches. So now we have to decide what are the distinguishing features of all of these headaches. And we're going to build our illness scripts for these. And so we know that those primary headaches tend to be recurrent, and so most of these tend to be the first time that they've had these headaches. So new onset, not recurrent, would probably fit in all of the illness scripts for all of these. for the stroke syndromes, you can have some hard neurologic findings. That means findings that would match an area of a stroke, like hemiparesis, aphasia, and maybe they have some dizziness and ataxia. And actually, I would put that under the cerebellar infarct, which would also lead to a stroke of the cerebellum, which causes the dizziness and ataxia. Subarachnoid hemorrhage is going to have usually be sudden in onset and maximal at onset. It's going to be that thunderclap headache that you have. Yeah, they'll probably have some nuclear rigidity. They may have some neurologic findings, but these are the things that you really want to ask about. Carotid and vertebral artery dissections are also going to have hard neurologic findings because they're going to cause a stroke, and it's also going to be sudden onset, and they're going to have neck pain with this. It's usually going to happen after some kind of mild trauma, like even just turning your head or shaving is all it takes to do this. Those patients with an epidural or a subdural are going to have some sort of trauma, right? Whether it's occult or an obvious trauma, they may be coagulopathic, and that might be old people as well, or it might be people on Coumadin, or it might be alcoholics. And think about vulnerable patients like prisoners or a kid, you know, babies who might get shaken baby, and prisoners who get beat up in jail. Patients with glaucoma, you're worried about those who have eye pain or visual changes. Remember, it's that you go into the movie theater, the lights go down, and then all of a sudden you get a lot of pain in the eye. For carbon monoxide, you're going to worry about patients that others at home have headaches. Maybe there's, you know, uncle and cousins and even the dogs puking. And so you got to worry about that, especially in the beginning of winter when you start turning on your furnace for the first time and that releases the carbon monoxide. Temporal arteritis, you got to worry about, you know, the old lady who's got temporal pain or jaw claudication. And it doesn't take much to start thinking of that in those older people. And for tumor, you're going to have progressive daily headaches that are just getting worse and worse, and usually some neurologic finding with it, too. Oh, I almost forgot two beautiful ones here. Meningitis. Think about that in the person who has fever and a headache. Not everybody with a fever and a headache is going to have meningitis, of course, right? But you can look at the nuclear rigidity, etc. Brudzinski and Koenigsegg, not so great, but nuclear rigidity, I would look for that, too. And if it's concerning, if they also have sick contacts that also have meningitis, as well as the immunocompromised who tend to present atypically. And for dural venous thrombosis, which is basically a DVT of the head, you know, the pregnant patients tend to get that, or the ones who just recently delivered. So remember to ask if they just recently had a baby. Now, this is our list of details that we have when we use top-down processing, right? New onset headache, hard neurologic findings, dizzy ataxia, neck pain, all of these things together should be documented on your chart. Now, this could be your illness script for stroke, and this one for epidural hemorrhage, and this one for temporal arteritis. And so you have to make sure that you address all of these. So when you come up with a differential diagnosis for headache, it should not just include a few things like temporal, like a subdural, subarachnoid, and meningitis, but it should have that entire giant list that we just made. All of these diagnoses here, and you need to prove to yourself that your patient does not have any of these. And so now you got a list of red flags that you should include on every chart of every patient that comes in with a headache, and that you should also include in your presentation. And here are all of those features. And all of these features came from our differential diagnosis. And this is top-down thinking. We start with the diseases. We started with these diseases. And then we went down to the details, and we came up with a list of details here that we're going to look for. And those are our illness scripts. Those are also our red flags that we need to diagnose. And so you want to do that for every patient that you see with headache, chest pain, abdominal pain, shortness of breath, altered mental status, etc., to make sure that you thought of all the bad things. And so this concludes our first video on clinical thinking. If you have any questions, please let me know in the comments or email me or whatever. And the next one, we're going to go over what you do after your history and physical. Thanks, and thank you for watching. Bye.